We know from a scientific standpoint that neurons, nerve cells that exist in the brain, when they connect, they exchange information. And as they connect and they exchange information, that connecting point is a learned understanding related to a concept. As I said, when we remember something, we activate those connections again and bring them to life. Now, we have enormous amounts of connections in our brain, infinite connections, just about trillions and trillions of connections. And every place where those neurons connect and exchange information, it's mapped as a pattern or a sequence that reflects some idea, something that we've learned, a trait, a behavior, a skill, a tendency, a feeling even. And all these connections are the sum total of who we are as an individual. So everybody's different because they have had different experiences in their life, they've learned different knowledge, and they have a certain amount of genetic connections that they're given. And that's basically the foundation of where we start from as individuals. Now, most people at a certain point in their life rely on those developed circuits and never learn anything new. They allow feeling to become the means of thinking. They stop learning and they start feeling. And when we get to the point where learning is stopped and feeling is initiated, that's when we're living out our genetic propensities. That's when we're living out the predetermined genetic future that exists for us as individuals. When we learn new knowledge, the brain begins to reformat itself. It begins to fire in new sequences and new patterns and in new connections. And if we can maintain those connections for an extended period of time, we can modify and change our behavior. And those people who had spontaneous remissions, what they did was they gained knowledge and they began to apply that knowledge by asking what ifs. And they understood if they could connect with that intelligence that was keeping their heart beating and digesting their food, if they could whisper in the ear of the giant that was running their physical body, that knew how to make cells, that knew how to organize DNA, if they could have their will match its will, if they could have their mind match its mind, if they could have their love of life match its love of life, because it was what was continuously giving them life. If they reasoned that by changing their thoughts, would it send a new signal to their cells? And by patterning new connections in their brain, would it ultimately produce a new physiological effect in their body? So the reinvention process meant to reorganize those circuits to a greater ideal of themselves. Now, we have a couple different types of learning that we have in the brain. We have learning divided in two different areas. When we learn something and we memorize it, one particular area is called what's called explicit learning. Now, explicit learning, another name for it, is called declarative learning or declarative memory. Declarative memories are things that we can declare. One of the aspects of declarative memory is knowledge, information, philosophy. For example, if you learn new information, new knowledge, intellectual data, philosophy, every time we do that, the brain makes particular type of circuits. The second type of declarative memory is called experience. Experience, then, are things that we can declare. We can declare that I'm a man, I can declare that I know where I was on 9/11, I can declare that I like apples because I've had those experiences. So the memory systems in the brain that have to do with declarative memories have a very specific sequence in which the brain formats that information. It's formatted in the thinking brain. It's formatted in the part of the brain where conscious awareness exists. And that particular sequence of knowledge and experience allows the brain to function in reality. We can function in the external environment because we use declarative memory consciously to make decisions. We use declarative memory consciously to project the future. We're using declarative memory to function in our world, to make decisions every single day. And that type of memory system is intact so that we can function in our world. Now, the second type of memory system is called implicit memories. Now, implicit memory systems are very powerful systems because implicit memories are things that we can't declare. It's called non-declarative memory. That non-declarative memory are things like skills and habits and conditionings and traits and propensities and even behaviors. That those traits and behaviors have been practiced and executed so many times that we no longer have to think about it anymore. They're called procedural memories. And we have hundreds of procedural memories that's formatted in our brain. Now those procedural memories are things like driving a stick shift in our car. When we drive a stick shift in our car, we've practiced it so many times that we don't even have to think about it anymore. It's wired neurologically as a complete circuit. When we brush our teeth, when we put on makeup, when we type, when we walk, those are all procedural or non-declarative memories. And the brain processes that information differently because it goes beyond our conscious thoughts, goes beyond our conscious memories. It's wired to us so that we don't even have to declare it. For example, when you can't remember a phone number consciously in your explicit system, you could grab the phone and look at the numbers and your hands will begin to move and you'll remember the numbers. That's called an implicit memory because your body's practiced it so much, it remembers it as well as your brain. Now, implicit memories are the point in which we hardwire behavior. Implicit memories are when we are actually it. Implicit memories are when we've completely made a change. So if we think about it, if we make connections in the brain by learning knowledge is beginning to make new circuits. That's philosophy. The brain has changed as a result of it. But there isn't much change in terms of sending signals to the body, new information to the body. It's intellectual information. When we have a new experience, when we personalize that knowledge, when we take knowledge and we personalize it or apply it, we can set up a new experience. And that new experience then allows us to format and change our behavior. So knowledge then applied creates a new experience. That experience then creates a certain amount of circuits in the brain that further advances the knowledge that we learn. And we can declare that we've had a new experience. So knowledge is thinking. It is our thinking brain. When we learn new knowledge, we learn that knowledge to think from. Experience requires applying that knowledge, and we call that doing. That's the doing aspect of how the brain learns. So we could have an experience based on knowledge that we've learned. We can apply that knowledge and have a new experience, but that isn't enough. Because when we have a new experience, the idea then is to be able to repeat that experience. And when we can repeat that experience over and over again, we begin to wire to that implicit memory system, and that new way of remembering something is called being it. We're actually being it now. So learning new knowledge is the thinking part of our brain. Applying that knowledge, applying what we've learned, applying our thought to have a new experience, modifying our behavior to have a new experience is called the doing it. And then when we continuously are able to repeat that experience over and over again, and repeat it over and over again, we begin to wire the brain to that implicit system called being it. Now, when we're being something, we don't have to think about it anymore. It's wired permanently. That process is natural. It's second nature. It's easy. And those people who had spontaneous remissions, as they began to gain new knowledge and apply that knowledge to set up some new experiences for themselves, they didn't stop there. They went further until that system was hardwired in their body, till they actually were able to become it. You see, once we can become something, now it's wired permanently so that we no longer have to think about it. And the idea then is if there's automatic systems in our brain, automatic programs in our brain that define thinking and feeling our entire life, thinking as a victim, thinking as an insecure person. And if we think those insecure thoughts, it makes the chemicals that make us feel insecure. See, then once we feel insecure, then the brain starts to think the way it's feeling. So those people who had spontaneous remissions from diseases, those people who heal themselves of different conditions, they made some pretty physical changes in their brain. The changes that they made weren't just about intellectually embracing this information. It wasn't just about having an experience once. They wanted to actually become somebody else. And when they reinvented themselves, when they said, "I believe there's an intelligence that exists within me that gives life to every single individual, whether they're happy or sad, whether they're wealthy or poor, whether they're holy or unholy, that some intelligence gives life to every human being. If I could tap into that intelligence and become somebody else, it'll give life to who this new person emerges as. And that if my thoughts matter, I'm going to have to really construct some permanent neurological connections in my brain to become this new platform of being. And that I have to abandon and surrender that old way of thinking and feeling that was really tied to my environment, really tied to the way in which I thought about my world based on my old self. And maybe those old feelings and those old connections were really tied to old experiences. And maybe by reinventing myself, there'll be a period where I have no feeling. Maybe those old emotions and those old feelings were tied to some old experience that were actually the cause of the condition in the first place. And by abandoning those old thoughts and those old feelings, just abandoning those and replacing it with a new idea of self, that a new signal was running to the body and the person was actually free. And then all they had to do was separate themselves from people and things and the distraction of the environment and time and episodes and events and let thought become more real than anything else. In the process of rehearsing, in the process of thinking about who they wanted to become, in the process of thinking about it over and over again, they began to make those circuits more permanent. They began to create a new individual. They began to emerge as a new being. And as a result of it, that process where they developed the skill of paying attention, they developed the ability to move their mind away from their body. They developed the ability to move their mind away from the environment. And they even moved their mind away from the reference of time. And the moment they did that, maybe the door to the quantum field opened. Maybe now they were stepping into a new level of mind. And when that happens, when we can make thought more real than anything else, the brain begins to format those patterns and connections that are equal to who we are and who we're becoming. So these people who had spontaneous remissions, maybe it wasn't a miracle at all. Maybe they just became somebody else. And maybe they believed that this intelligence would stand behind them and give life to whoever they were being. And maybe this intelligence was smarter than them and brighter than them and had more will than them to step in and reorganize their body for them. And that all they had to do was to become somebody different. And when they became somebody different, this intelligence gave life to them and their life changed, their health changed, and their future changed.